necessary transformation right now. I believe in a full culture shift in the way our Minneapolis Police Department operates. Culture, to a certain extent, is about people. It's about personnel. You don't get that full culture shift unless you are able to bring officers in and retain those that have the right mindset and get officers out that do not. For many different mayoral and chief terms, we've seen mayors and chiefs alike thwarted by several dynamics that prevent that necessary culture shift, that prevents those necessary disciplinary and termination actions so that we can, in fact, change the game within our police culture. We've seen collective bargaining agreements, the police federation, and the arbitration process that returns as much as 45% of cases back to the city. Let me be clear. Chief Arredondo and I can discipline or terminate an officer 45% of the time, and sometimes more. That decision gets overturned, and the officer that has broken so much public trust gets returned right back to the police department from where they started. Now, we need policy changes, too. And over the coming months, you will see a consistent drumbeat of policy changes coming from both myself and Chief Arredondo. But let me be clear. Culture eats policy for breakfast. And unless we can tackle those necessary elephants in the room, being the arbitration, the federation, and the collective bargaining agreement, we won't see the transformational change that we're talking about. We need to see clear vision and clarity. We need to be clear and precise about what exactly we're going to do and when. This amendment to our legal city charter does not provide clarity. There are more questions that I have regarding this amendment than answers. If this amendment passes, will we still have police? If you vote for this, are you voting to abolish the police department? Or is this merely a cosmetic change where you add a bureaucratic layer, you change the name to peace officers, and you give them different uniforms? Are we talking about getting rid of the police entirely? Or is this simply lip service? What are we talking about here? Is this about reductions in staff, or is this a wholesale elimination of police response to violent crime? I still can't answer that question. Next question. Is this a demotion of our police chief, Arredondo? Does the person who has embodied the ideals of compassion and integrity in Chief Arredondo, this is a person that has sued our police department for racial discrimination and won. This is a person that is chock full of integrity. He is now our chief. He has my support. Does this amendment eliminate his ability to lead that transformative change that we all want to see? Is he still the person at the helm of the Minneapolis public safety response? I can't answer that question either. Here's another question. All 12 council members and I signed a resolution, and that resolution promised, it committed, to have a year-long engagement process where we would seek input from our black and brown communities, where we would seek input from residents throughout our city to determine what path to move forward on. And despite that promise to listen to black and brown communities, centering them at the very middle of the conversation, we're presupposing an outcome right now and plowing ahead with a dramatic shift of the structure of the department. Let me be clear what that structure is. Right now, and by the way, this is one of the few things that we do know about this amendment. Right now, when something bad happens, or good, it is very clear who's accountable. Chief Arredondo is accountable, and I am accountable. if this charter amendment were to pass through, you would have the head of public safety report to 14 different people, myself and 13 council members. Every time something bad happens, it'll be a big finger-pointing contest. Every time something good happens, everybody will be rushing to take credit. That's not a system that works either in a time of crisis or on a day-to-day basis. We need to have clarity here. We need to have clarity in command. We need to have clarity in responsibility. We need to have clarity in vision. This amendment does not bring that forward. And so right now we stand on the precipice of making these necessary transformative changes. We are in the position right now to collectively harness all of that energy and frustration and sadness and anger and channel it to real change and channel it to something specific. That's the vision that we need to lay out right now. We need precision, and the precision of our solutions must match the precision of the harm that was initially inflicted. And so 10 and 15 and 20 years from now, we can look back. And either Minneapolis was the place where the status quo remained, where we engaged in half measures, where we weren't specific, we weren't precise, we weren't clear, and therefore got nothing done. Or we could be the city where we all rose up, united in purpose, united in cause, and said, this is the time where clear structural change will take place. Minneapolis can be that city, and I am confident that we will go in that direction. I'll open it to any questions.
Mayor, the council today in discussing this amendment expressed frustration that they don't have any authority beyond budget and chief's appointment and to push any reforms or needed change. You sat on the council too. What's your response to that frustration? They say that without this change, they feel that they have no power.
The council, as has repeatedly been the case, does have power. They have power in that they're able to amend the budget process. They have power in that they're able to legislate. They do have power over vast majority of departments throughout the city. If you go and check around in other cities and the structure that they have set up, there's one thing that has been very clear, and that there needs to be clear command, there needs to be clear accountability, and that if you're going to manage police, there needs to be clarity in direction. And if you're in the position where you are reporting to 14 different bosses on matters of public safety, I don't believe there's clarity in that. If the voters are looking to hold someone responsible for things going wrong or things going well, they don't have that clarity either. You could even set up a dynamic where you had different police responses or different policing tactics or different numbers of police simply based on the ward in which the action was taking place. You know, I'm a believer in accountability, and I don't see that through this structure. Not to mention, this structure, this massive change to our structure presupposes that this is actually what the community wanted. I'll note that a very similar amendment came forward about 2 years ago. 2 years ago, right after an officer-involved shooting, 6 months into my term, 6 months into Chief Arredondo's term or so, an amendment that was rushed came forward that would have the chief of police report to 14 different people, all 13 council members, and the mayor. There was a big rush. There was a frenzy of activity. It went through the Charter Commission. And guess what has happened in the 2 years since? Nothing. Nothing. No community engagement, no outreach to determine whether that was something that people wanted. And yet again, this time, we've sat down and we've all said, we agree that there needs to be a community engagement process. We've all said, all 12 council members and myself have said very clearly that we need to hear from black and brown voices. But that part, that section of this amendment, which by the way is the only part that has true clarity, totally bypassed that process. I believe the voters should have a say, but I believe that they should know what they're voting on when they decide to. The notion of amending a charter, the constitution of our city, is a very serious thing. And these times call for very serious measures. But in getting to those measures, people need to know what they're doing. They need to know what they're voting on. And, you know, under the plan, as we would be going forward, under the proposed charter amendment, we would be voting on an ambiguous proposal with ambiguous outcomes, then engage people afterwards that might be representative of the population or not in terms of that ambiguous proposal. And then we're just to trust council members to engage on the will of the people. I mean, why don't we do it differently? Why don't we be very honest and frank about this and say, should we abolish the police or not? That would be a clear question that could be put on the ballot. This lacks structure, this lacks clarity, and I think the voters at the very least deserve that.
Mayor, what's the path that you want to see through what you call deep structural change and a culture shift?
I mentioned this right off the bat, but I will again. A culture shift is about people. Culture is about people. It is about the personnel. And there are several pieces that get us to that front, but one of the major impediments has been an inability to terminate, to discipline officers that in some cases have had very wrongful and egregious conduct. One of those barriers, as I mentioned, was the Police Federation. One of them is the collective bargaining process and the bureaucracy that you have to work through. And then the ultimate one is this arbitration provision that, as I mentioned, has as much or more than 45% of cases overturned and sent right back to the city. And by the way, they're sent back in many cases after 1 or 2 years. And so that puts police chiefs in the very tenuous situation where if they want to shift the culture, if they want to remove an individual that has not stood by the values of compassion and integrity, they're set with the question as to whether they can act that their decision will actually stick. And in many cases, after a 1 or 2 year process, it doesn't. And that individual, that officer, is sent back to the same police department to continue to break trust with community. That doesn't work. Now, it's not just that. It's not just the arbitration provision, the collective bargaining agreement, and the Police Federation. It's also making sure that we have the right reporting structure in place. It's making sure that we're able to gather data and analytics that help us predict wrongful conduct in some of these critical incidents before they even happen. It's making sure that when officers fill out reports following a use of force, they are also mentioning whatever measures were used to de-escalate the situation, why the specific use of force was necessary that they gave. It's making sure that they're informing both their supervisor, but also writing it directly into the report itself. And then, even if their supervisor changes, we can have a system that is set up that allows for those actions to be followed. It allows for all of that data and analysis to actually run with the officers so that we're able to then predict future patterns of behavior.
Mayor, if you could talk about that some more, about spotting problematic officers, your reaction to the funding falling flat from the Minneapolis Foundation, what kind of a setback do you think that is, and what do you plan to do to replace that money?
So the question was about, and I apologize, I should have been repeating these questions aloud for the live stream, but the question was about the funding source from the Minneapolis Foundation. And it is disappointing. That was a funding source that we were very much hoping to get. But I know that there are both a number of of nonprofits and external partners and foundations that are very interested in helping this cause of transformation and change in our police department. And yes, so I will be reaching out to them. Additionally, we could also fund it through city monies as well. So I feel that some form of data and analytics system is really important regardless of the structure of the police department. You need to know what conduct is happening, and that conduct needs to be able to follow the officer. We need to be able to predict some of these events before they happen, and the system will help with that.
How much does something like that cost? I know Benchmark says it's 3 to 9 months to get a program in place. How much would the city have to pay to get it, and what's the time frame now that funding fell out?
I don't want to comment directly on the precise price tag. These systems usually run in the range of between $100,000 and $300,000, but we're going to be looking into that as we move forward. The question was on the veto topic, whether I would veto or not. I'm going to be reaching out to experts around the country and community members in our city over the next several days and weeks. I can tell you right now that the charter amendment as written, I do not think is a good idea. I do not think that it is good governance. I do not think that it, I think it's a blow to accountability, and I think it lacks clarity. But as to the question as to whether I should veto it, I haven't made that decision yet, but I will be.
Regarding the collective bargaining agreement, it sounds like this is where you would like to start in terms of police reform. Is that accurate to go into that agreement and change things to provide for more accountability? Is that the starting point, you think?
I think that the question was whether I view the collective bargaining agreement as the starting point for police accountability. I think there are many measures that need to be tackled simultaneously. There are policy changes that we can do unilaterally from the city level. There are pieces that require some form of change to the collective bargaining agreement. There are changes that need to be made through state law, including the arbitration provision. And what I want to make clear is that regardless of the policy changes that are made at the city, if we're really going to tackle that elephant in the room, if we really care about culture shift, we can't brush aside arbitration. We can't brush aside the collective bargaining agreements. These are pieces that for generations, mayors and chiefs alike have been thwarted in their efforts for change. I think we really need to be talking seriously about how these measures have in the past hindered us, but then how they could help us transform going into the future. We're working right now with our city staff that will be involved and have been involved in the negotiations. As the chief has stated very clearly, he felt that the landscape had dramatically shifted following the killing of George Floyd, and that it was necessary first to go back and have a reset of the contract itself and be making sure we were digging into every single provision.
There is a
I'm not totally clear. So the question was, is my reading of this amendment mean that Chief Arredondo is out? I'm not clear. I think that is a question that should be asked, but I don't want to speak for council members or the authors. We have our first black chief who is doing everything that he can to bake procedural justice into every facet of community engagement and work and safety. He is someone that champions these necessary reforms and is willing to step up in a big way and has. He's someone who literally interviews each and every new cadet that comes in the door to make sure they are of the right mentality, that they are of the right mindset to subscribe to the vision that he has laid out. I believe in our chief. I'm standing by our chief. And to the extent that this amendment demotes him or relieves him of power, or makes it even more difficult for him because he's now got to report to 14 different people, a structural change that was done without any form of community engagement. I think that's all a problem. So the question, to repeat, isn't it the situation where several other departments in the city have 14 different bosses? Yes, you are right. CPED director has 14 different bosses. Regulatory services director have 14 different bosses. There is a difference between doing economic development work and policing. There is a difference in terms of the necessary command and control that is essential through policing functions and other departments. I have been before all of you in the media, numerous times over the last several years. The most intense occasions, the instances where you really need to hear from a singular voice, the issues where you all, media and public alike, really needed to hold somebody accountable, every one of those has been a police issue. I'm about accountability here. If this is about me, well, there's an election next year. But if this is about me, then going to change the entire charter in eternity into the future, I think that's the wrong move. Well, let me be clear. There's sort of two facets to what this charter amendment lays out. One of them lacks definition and lacks clarity. The other is fairly specific. So let me first talk about the piece that lacks clarity. It's not clear as to whether this is getting rid of police. It's not clear as to whether in a year from now or in a year and a half from now, we will still have a police department or division that would be able to respond to violent incidents. It's not clear. It's not clear exactly who would be the head of public safety. It's not clear whether Chief Arredondo would be able to be the head of public safety. None of that is clear. I don't have answers for you. I'm not the one to answer that question. There is a part that is clear, though. The part that is clear is that it would reshape the structure so that whoever is the head of public safety would have to report to 14 different people, 13 council members and the mayor. And that decision was made without community engagement. It ignored the resolution that we all just voted on to reach out to communities throughout our city. And I do not believe that it upholds accountability. In fact, I think it's a massive blow to accountability. Right now, when something goes wrong, there are two people accountable, Chief Arredondo and myself. As difficult as that accountability metrics may be, it is necessary. Yeah. The question was whether I think this amendment will make it to the ballot in November. I don't want to comment on the procedural mechanisms that would or would not result in it getting on the ballot, but either you can talk to the council members or the clerk. Obviously, it does need to go through a charter commission process first.
Mayor, are you at all concerned that some of the businesses downtown, with all this going on, just may say, we're going somewhere else?
Can you ask that question one more time, please?
Are you concerned at all that businesses downtown are paying, just decide, we're going to go somewhere else. We're going to go to a suburb or something and leave downtown Minneapolis because of all the defunding that
So the question was whether I am concerned about any of these businesses downtown or in any part of the city making a decision to go elsewhere. That's always a concern. I don't want to speak for businesses, but of course we want businesses to remain and function and thrive in our city. We need them. They're part of Minneapolis. They're an important part. They pay property taxes. They allow our city functions to continue. They employ people. And most certainly, yes, we do want to keep them.
Last question.
Does the fire department operate under all 14?
Under this amendment?
No. Does the fire department currently operate as this amendment?
Fire department is set up slightly differently. Yeah.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Great. Thank you.
Disconnect.